Hello, everyone, and welcome to today's SANS webcast, Why It's Easy Being a Hacker. My name is Carol Auth of SANS, and I will be moderating today's webcast. Today's featured speaker is Chris Dale, SANS Certified Instructor. If during the webcast you have any questions for our presenter, please enter them into the questions window located on the GoToWebinar interface at any time. Please note that this webcast is being recorded, and a copy of the slides and recording of this webcast will be available for viewing later today and can be found on the SANS registration page. And with that, I'd like to hand the webcast over to Chris.
Thank you very much, Carol. Hello, everyone. I'm nice to see people are showing up on my webcast on It's Easy Being a Hacker. And why is that? Well, we're going to do some case studies and figure out why it's easy to be a hacker. Keep in mind, also, hackers, they can target everyone. They're not necessarily limited to one application and so on. So they do have a bit of an easier game, I would say. Now, first of all, who am I? Chris Dale is my name, and I've been teaching for SANS for multiple years now. Multiple certs, as you can see. You can see my baseball bat over there, which I use for some presentations sometimes. I call it an ISMD, an information security motivational device. It's very handy when you want to crush some screens or crush some keyboards in case people are not complying with your security authority, right? Well, anyways, I do love what I do. And right now I'm head of cybersecurity at NetSecurity based in Norway, Bergen. So even though I might sound a bit American, I'm actually from Europe, from Norway. So if you're from the same region, come say hi, please. All right. So I was asking myself this question: why is it so ridiculous that we have SQL injection running on like 20 years of history now? SQL injection at this age still is a problem. And I asked myself, why? What's going on here? Why can't we get rid of seemingly simple problems like SQL injection? I've also been a developer myself, so I've made mistakes myself. I know I go to Stack Overflow, copy paste some code and so on. I know what it's all about. So I wanted to take a deep dive. I took a deep dive into, first of all, Google. What happens when you develop from Google, like based out of Google results? I have a problem. I want to code it. I Google the solution, copy paste some stuff off some blog sites, some Stack Overflow here, some tutorials here. What's up with that? Then I thought about the books that I've been using for coding, the books that you've been using for coding. I was lucky enough to have a repository of more than 10,000 tech books all about coding and IT operations and so on. I believe it was called Safari Books back in the days. And I used that subscription to basically walk through a ton of books to see how well they teach us to code. What's up with their coding practices? Are they showing us the best practice, the secure solutions, or are they showing us vulnerable results? Then I was thinking about schools. Well, the schools that I've been attending and you've been attending, what do they teach us? What about the professors? Do they know about cybersecurity? I know some of you right now, you're thinking, haha, no, my professor did not. And maybe we'll see that this is a common theme around the world, that professors and the people who teach us, getting us ready for going into work, they might not be necessarily prepared for security problems at the same time. And then, of course, online courses and physical courses. What about when you procure training? Do they teach you how to produce secure results and get secure solutions? So I started out with Google. This is my Google search. How to use PHP with MySQL. How many of you have been doing this query yourselves? Like, you've probably done this. If you were into development or you wanted to do a prototype of something, you've probably done a similar search one time now or in the past. So I was curious, out of the top 10 of Google, how many of the results are vulnerable? How many are weak? And the results were shocking. This is the results from 2013. I've done the same study last year as well. So from Google, five of the results of the top 10 results were vulnerable to SQL injection in 2013. That's crazy, ridiculous. Get out of here. That's crazy. All right. Even mysql.com was vulnerable to SQL injection. That means they're showing you code that has vulnerable examples in them. Also, a lot of the other pages that I assessed, they did not teach you how to do input control. So basically, they just showed you SQL, how to connect to a database and run static queries. But who likes static queries? We kind of like to have queries based on user input for searching and updating and deleting stuff. That's kind of what we use SQL for. So if they don't show you how to deal with user input, they're kind of failing already. So the results were kind of shocking, and it was really bad. How about 2019? So last year, not many months ago, I did the same study. Number one, two, three, they did not show you how to accept user input. And that's the most dangerous function you can actually do within web security, is to accept user input. And they don't show you how to do it. Do you know why? I'm gonna guess. They don't show you why because they don't wanna deal with that hairy problem. They just wanna, let someone else deal with that. Security, someone else fix this stuff. We're not going to deal with user input in our tutorials and our code examples just because we're not sure how to fix this. You also saw that result number four here. It started out insecure, but it actually showed you how to make it secure as you went through the tutorial, which is fine. And also there were some vulnerable results down the line here, 7 and 10. You also see 6 and 9. They actually had very weak coding practices, showing error messages to the users, and basically they got hairy solutions presenting to their users. So that's not good at all. Here's an example, tutorialspoint.com. I have no quarrel with those guys. I have no clue who they are. I just Googled this stuff and they popped up. So I assume they're quite a bit used in the industry. I've never used them before. Anyone see the problem here? Anyone see this employee ID, employee salary coming in from the post array over here? Well, I wonder what happens when we put these values directly into SQL. We put those values directly into the SQL without any kind of sanitization, filtering whatsoever. Hence, this database will be owned. It will be popped. It's just a matter of time. Anyone who copy-pastes this code example, modify it for their use, they will have a vulnerable database. What about PHP.NET? Also had vulnerabilities. However, PHP.NET were very reluctant in showing you how to deal with user input. So instead, someone in the comment section, they contributed. And here you can see that someone writing some code in German here, they have provided you with a vulnerable code example. Now this is on this MySQL I Connect function, the web page on php.net. This is the topmost comments, if I remember correctly, but it does have minus 11 or something votes. So you will see that it's been grayed out slightly to kind of illustrate that people are not, they're not endorsing this solution. However, it's still up there, it's still live, it's not getting deleted whatsoever, and I'm sure people are copy-pasting out of this stuff and using it for their solutions. And here's the prime examples when not accepting user input. This is the W3 Schools, very popular webpage. Basically, they're also Norwegians, by the way, but basically they just said, no, I don't wanna deal with any user input, so I'm gonna hard code any type of input values, like dough, I'm just gonna hard code dough, not gonna accept it from the users whatsoever. Hence, the solution is secure. The solution might also be secure if you're not online. If you just keep it offline, if you don't turn on your computer, it might be secure. So there are basically lots of vulnerabilities and not a lot of best practices being demonstrated to people Googling today. There's other search queries we can do. For example, how to program MySQL and PHP login field, for example. You will see tutorials like this. Tons of shares here. 5 steps to create a simple secure login script in PHP and MySQL. Notice the secure part here. People start to code, and what do they see? SQL injection. Now, this codingcyber.org, they're not bad, but they're just showing you a tutorial on how to make a login field with PHP and MySQL, except as they run through the code, they show you the insecure versions first, and then at the end of the tutorial, they show you how to make it secure. Why? Please, someone, please tell me why can't we just teach security from the beginning instead of adding it at the end? Because you know what people are doing, right? They look at this tutorial, they get to step number 5, They put it into the develop application and they see it works. Finally, I can now customize this so it works for my solution and you don't continue with the tutorial. Hence, their solution is going to be in production vulnerable. Really bad. There's also another vulnerability on this web page. Someone might see it, but if you take a look, there's another class of vulnerability here. There's actually a cross-site scripting vulnerability down here. Hi, username. So that contains no filtering, and you can basically register to this subset here, probably with a cross-site script, and allow it to be a sort of cross-site scripting avenue. So there's basically, this problem is a lot of places. There is a lot of examples where they will show you vulnerable examples, and there's also those places I just showed you, and others where they will show you that, hey, we have this tutorial, here's how to make it a vulnerable example, and then at the end of the tutorial, they will basically show you how to make it more secure. This reminds me of a story from when I just took a class from a Norwegian college. So I got this email from the college saying that, hey, as an alumni student, we want to offer you a free class at our school. It's all online based, it's across 10 weeks or something. You're gonna show up 2 hours a week to basically attend an online class on server 2016 administration in Azure. So I was thinking, well, why not? They want my input. I know some Azure, I know some server 2016 stuff. Why don't I attend? And we're basically using Skype for Business to see what the professor is showing us. So the professor is doing screen sharing. He's logging onto Azure. I can see the port number of his Azure instance, RDP1. I can see he's typing in a username of a local administrator. He's typing in a password, which is masked, obviously. And the class goes on like this. At day two of the class, so the second meeting we have, I noticed that when he typed in his password, it seemed a bit too good to be true. It's like when he typed it in, it was like a fixed frequency of letters being typed in, like ding, 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 like a machine gun. Ba, 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 ba. You can see the stars coming in. And I'm thinking, that's a bit strange. I wonder if his password is 123456789. So before the next class, I decided to just to test. And sure enough, I could log in to his RDP online VM in Azure with the password 123456789. No big deal. I was just thinking, well, okay, that's pretty bad. And I decided to have a prank on him. So on his desktop, I put in a notepad.txt where I just typed in, hey, hacked. And basically the professor comes in later. He starts up the presentation. He starts to do a demo of some user administration and his demo breaks. He can't make it work. And he's stressing out. He's getting kind of upset. He's like, what's wrong with this presentation? What's wrong with my demo? I can't figure it out. And then he noticed the text document on his desktop saying hacked. He reads it and he says, oh, this is why the demo is not working. I've been hacked. And I'm like, really? Come on. I'm just telling myself, right? I'm just looking at his screen over Skype for Business. But then he goes on to say, this must be Chris. And I'm like, to everyone, to all the other students, I'm like, holy cow, how can you accuse me of such a thing? Okay, of course it was me, but how could you accuse me of such a thing? That's uncalled for. Anyways, let's fix your problem, all right? Let's take care of the demo that didn't work and help you out. So we help him out, he gets back up and running, and he changes his password in front of everyone, live, online. So he types in the old password, 123456789, and then he starts to type in his new password. And I can see the stars coming up on his screen, right? I can see the stars showing up. And if I can also hear the key presses on his keyboard. Like I would click on this keyboard right now, you can hear the keyboards. You can hear the key presses, I'm assuming. So I listen very carefully. I'm even recording the session. And I can hear click, and there are no stars coming up on the screen, which means that's a shift. So he types in shift. There's no characters. Then he types in click, 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 click. And just by listening to that string typed in, knowing that the first character is most likely a shift, that there was a frequency of two rapid letters in the middle, two rapid letters at the end, I told my teacher, I said, hey, is your new password, does it start with a capital letter?
have a double consonant in the middle and ends with two numbers. And my professor was shocked. He thought I had hacked Microsoft. And I'm like, dude, I just had code execution on your box. I could have installed a keylogger, which I haven't, but I'm just pranking you, man. I'm just guessing your password. But it goes on to say, so it goes on to show you that the professors, they're used to demonstrating weak examples. No, this is just for testing. This is just for demo. And we have this notion that everything should be made insecure first, and then we add security afterwards. And that's a really, really bad practice. Just don't do it. So how should the professor have done it? Well, he should have been using like a password manager or something to just have a random and strong password for his demo service. It's not a big deal. It's easy. Now, you want to be a hacker today? This is what you type into Google. Type in the following Google dirt in URL colon, and you're looking for scripts that ends with .php, and they have a little query parameter called id equals. Now, this is ridiculous, but this works. And OMG, it works really well. It's ridiculous. How many websites out there that are vulnerable to SQL injection today? Now, be careful, guys. I don't want you to go out there and try to hack people at random. I've done that for you, all right? So here you see an example. Of course, I've been removing the domain names, but they're really not that hard to find because the top 50 web pages of Google, if you search for PHP, ASP.NET, any type of scripts with the ID equals, you will find so many vulnerabilities. In this example, so you can see that I'm looking at product PHP, ID equals 21, and I'm adding a little percentage 27. Percentage 27 is just a simple tick. It's the tick character. This tick character here. And that's all it takes to find an SQL injection in some cases, or this one, unless they're blind. And you can see that we get an error message from the SQL database indicating that this is in fact a problem. This is in fact SQL injection. Here's another one. We can keep on going forever. There are so many websites out there vulnerable to SQL injection. It's not even fun. It's not even fun to find these things anymore because the internet is full of crap. It's full of vulnerabilities. And it's not a happy place. It's easy to be a hacker if you can target everyone. It's hard to be a pen tester when your scope is focused on one organization. Well, it's not that hard, but it's harder than being a criminal, for example. So conclusions based out of this. First of all, in terms of search engine optimization, getting your hits up there on Google, security does not impact it whatsoever today. I wish Google would rank weak code examples or whatever, tutorials that show you blatantly wrong things, for example, but they're just not gonna, right? Another thing, anyone can write a tutorial. Yes, anyone online can be an expert, and anyone can set up a website with some tutorials, and they might not show you good things. They might show you horrendously bad things. The internet is, again, full of crap. There's another word for that, but I think you know it. I also want to see, especially in youth and the younger generations, that they seek to understand before they seek to solve. So if they go out there to copy off some code of Stack Overflow, for example, ask the question, why does this work? How does it work? Because instead of just pasting it in and running it and forgetting about it, I want you to try to build that knowledge, to expand that knowledge so you can basically learn from it and ask vital questions such as, does this function look like it needs to, for example, filter input from the user? Is there any requirements to filter output, for example, to encode my data, to prevent it from being, from targeting my users that can see the data? And also a call for action to all of us who teach and who blog and who create YouTube tutorials or whatnot. Please understand, security is not something you add after the fact. There is no such thing as added security. Security must be inherent in your solutions for us to start to make it harder for hackers. Right? You don't buy a car and say, nah, I don't want brakes on this car. I only want brakes on the front wheels, not the back wheels. You just don't. It would be ridiculous. You can't buy a car without seatbelts. But online, everyone seems to think that no, you get the car without any type of security, and then every like security is an add-on. I don't like this. Now, a lot of us has been doing this, right? So I was thinking, myself included, I even have a sticker that says copy-pasting of Stack Overflow, but what about the advice being given on Stack Overflow? There's been some blogs on this, and you will see that there's a bunch of bad examples of Stack Overflow as well. Answers that provide you with solutions that are vulnerable. For example, here, you can see username, password are being used directly into the query down here. This is a vulnerable example. Now, there is a certain level of moderation on Stack Overflow and the other stack exchanges, so they can get removed. There's a lot of comments commenting that this is bad practice, so that's a good thing, right? Here you can see another example where this guy is building, I wouldn't say a complex example, but a more complex example than the previous ones. He's basically building this array of industries and exploding it into an array and so on. And he's building SQL dynamically via a loop here. And that's where the problem comes in. Because you can see that the IND variable here is being used directly in a query. And because it's being used directly in a query, it will actually lead to SQL injection as well. So the thing is, Stack Overflow, which is a great place, don't get me wrong, but a lot of people, they would be like full Stack Overflow developers. All they do is copy paste off Stack Overflow all day long, and they're introducing vulnerable examples to our customers and to our code bases around the world. There's also a problem with a lot of requirements. There's a lot of requirements for development to be cheaper and faster. Minimum viable products, you need to get something up really fast, and you have a tendency to forget about security. Like, I've literally heard on several occasions developers tell me that no, security might be added later, well, once we're out of staging, for example, because we don't have time for it. Now, that's just ridiculous. Now, and you have to fight. I wouldn't say fight, you have to level with the C-level executives saying that there is no such car without seatbelts. So why do you expect us to create a web application without security? And if you know your stuff, adding security is not that hard. Like using parameterized queries for SQL is not that hard. So why just not do it inherently for everything that you do? All right. What about technical literature? Now, my take on this, I've went through a lot of books. A lot of times it's this, right? What the beep is security? How to ignore it and deliver your projects. I love this O'Reilly book covers. They're so funny. This is one of my favorite memes ever. But I went through books. I went through many of them. For example, PHP, MySQL, The Missing Manual. Pretty much the entire book contains SQL injection. At the end of the book, the author finally introduces input sanitization. Now, how many of you are reading a development book from cover to cover and you finish the entire book? Not a lot of you, not a lot of us. No, we open up the chapters where we want to find information that teaches us how to do a certain thing. We implement it and it's vulnerable, unless you read the last chapter called security. This book had not only SQL injection, it had a ton of different vulnerabilities. The chapter 10 was called Security and the Real World. Like, when are you not in the real world? Like, I've been debating, are we in the matrix or not? But really, like, if you're gonna teach coding, you are in the real world. I don't care if you deploy it internally on the internet or in an air gap network, it should be secure. Come on, guys. I used to love the books Head First. They have like this amazing series on a lot of like very complex topics, but they have a tendency to describe it quite brilliantly for new users and newbies. So I was spending a lot of time on these books when I was learning myself to develop and working as a developer. And on chapter 6 is when they introduce security. Previously, everything is vulnerable. They introduce sanitization and basically security issues in chapter 6, securing your web application. But at the following examples in the following chapters, they just seem to have forgotten that they had a code, they had some examples on security, and they are no longer walking through secure examples in the book. Tons of other vulnerabilities in this book as well, like proper storage, there's cross-site scripting, just a lot of stuff. I can feel that I'm getting frustrated just by talking about these examples because they're just full of vulnerabilities. Just enough web programming with XHTML, PHP, and MySQL. I would call this book just not enough web programming because SQL injection was found in all code examples throughout the book. There's no security measures being added. It has a catchy name, but really it doesn't hold up, unfortunately. So some of the books I noticed that they would reference like other security books, but they would have like a little paragraph in one of the chapters saying that, hey, if you want to do things securely, you should look into security books. Here's an example. Also, in a lot of the books, now I just showed you some vulnerable examples, but in a lot of the books, the last chapter actually addressed security, and only a few books. And I went through probably 30, 40 books, and only in a few books were security actually inherently a part of the entire book from start to end. And that melted my heart. That was like, yes. Yes, I love these books. I want to know who the author is. I want to look at which other books they've written because I love that stuff. What about the authors? So I reached out to the authors. I said, hey, your books are full of vulnerabilities. What are you going to do about it? Well, they were really happy. They were thanking me. Well, thank you so much, dear reader, for pointing this out to me. I will have a second edition ready for you in no time. And it will boost my sales. I can sell even more books. And I look like a better author now. Thank you very much. Yes. So the thing is, terms of conclusions, just because you write a book does not make you an expert. All right. And also, we have to understand that technical literature is not something most people cover. Read through from cover to cover. You use them as a reference. You look up chapter 7 on SQL. You look up chapter 9 on XML. You're not supposed to read it from cover to cover. You have to build in secure examples throughout the book. Otherwise, we're going to lose. Then again, books, are they even good for IT? Like if you look at how rapidly web is changing from week to week, month to month, like there's new vulnerabilities, new classes of vulnerabilities, new JavaScript frameworks. There's new all the time. So the books, they're going to be outdated quite fast, I would assume. So I would encourage book authors to think of something else than a paper format. I would encourage professors in university to perhaps have a format that is easily updated and can be maybe in a more agile fashion, be able to update your material as this IT landscape changes. That's my hope, at least. All right. So I went to school. What about the schools and institutions? Well, NTNU, that's where I studied. Well, it was named something else when I studied there, but it's called NTNU now. And I wanted to run through some of my findings. First of all, my book, Programming in Java, absolutely no security. Now, I don't want to shame the authors of this book or whatever, but there is no mention of security. They did mention prepared statements at the end of the book in the final chapter, but only for performance reasons, not for security. So literally an entire book on how to develop in Java, and it's just written with vulnerabilities. It sucks. Web programming in PHP, this author, Sven, lovely guy, one of my favorite professors when I was studying, but really lackluster when it comes to security. Does not address it properly. And basically everything you see in terms of code, with some few exceptions where it's explicitly note, this is how you defeat SQL injection. Well, in all the other examples, they're vulnerable to SQL injection. Pretty bad. What about homework? Homework for students. Do you get an A if your code is vulnerable? And the answer to that question is, yes, you do. Because I went through homework. And I can see in people's homework that even though they get an A, they still have vulnerable code examples, SQL injection and database and so on. This just proves that security does not matter in terms of how you rate and evaluate. Security in many cases is a separate track that you add on after the fact of running other classes. The classes do not build in security as a concept. You have to study something else to learn about security. And that's just simply wrong. How has this happened? How did this happen that you take a class on databases and programming, you learn nothing about cybersecurity, you have to go study a separate class to learn about cybersecurity, and that's when you learn about not only SQL injection, you also learn about buffer overflows and all of it. It's just not a good model to teach students. But I guess there are solutions to these things. I guess you could pay for training, right? And the trainers, they should of course know their stuff. Well, being a bit sarcastic here, I'm a trainer myself, but the training I took was web development with Microsoft, ASP.NET, MVC3, right? I was working as a CISO, there was an extra opening in a class. I said, I can join if you have an extra seat. I joined for a week of class on how to program MVC3 in ASP.NET. I learned about racer views, MVC pattern, a lot of nice things. But at day three, I had to ask my instructor, so during lunch, by the way, in a very friendly manner, not a very hostile manner. I even pulled him to the side so no one else would hear my question. I asked him in private, hey, instructor, when are we gonna learn to code these examples in a secure fashion? Like maybe it's on day five or something, I don't know. And he tells me, no, sir, these examples are secure by default. It's all being taken care of the framework. The framework, yeah, with link and everything. Sure, but no, sir. Let me show you. If you want, we can do a live demo of this. And he, like, very nonchalantly, whatever that word is, basically in front of everyone, he gathers everyone, let's take a demo, guys. Let's see if our solution is vulnerable to SQL injection. Everyone gathers around the lunch table. He opens up his laptop, boots up the solution we've been creating for the week, and types in tick or tick one, tick or tick one. Runs that into his application and the entire database and the entire table falls through and everything is vulnerable. This guy went from having skin like I had to being pale white. And he said, wow, I have to go back to all my clients that I've been having for the past 3-4 years and help them with this problem. Because they are all vulnerable to this exact same issue. Of course, that's billable hours, so it's not a big deal for him. But still, that's ridiculous. The instructor had no clue that SQL injection was the thing. He just thought that the framework should take care of it for him. And I agree, the framework should, but it didn't. So is there a cure except hoping nobody hacks you? There are lots of things we can do, right? There are things. There are definitely things that we can improve on in our code base. For example, in terms of developers need to be defensive. They need to address, when they address input from users, and mind you, input can come from a lot of different places. It can come from input fields, it can come from headers, it can come from network side channels and so on. But when you receive input, be defensive. Know what data you're expecting. If you are expecting an age, just accept numbers. If you're expecting an IP address to ping something or to add something to an asset database, well, you should expect numbers, dots, maybe columns and A to E or A to F, sorry, if you have IP version 6. You have to be defensive in both your input and your output. Outputs are also important in terms of things like cross-site scripting and the likes. You need to think of sanitization. For everything, you need to wash your hands, right? You need to clean the data. Garbage in, garbage out, no such thing. You need to take that data, scrub it, make sure it doesn't contain any attacks in it. And the best way to do sanitization is through whitelisting. Whitelisting of the data. For example, using a regex pattern to basically limit the allowed characters for this input. Instead of blacklisting, which is the opposite, where you say these characters are forbidden. Blacklisting can be quite scary because very often I've seen that developers forget a certain few characters and so on, and it still allows us to run some pieces of code and the problem is still there. Parameterized queries though, is the preferred solution in all SQL going through your database. Wherever is applicable, parameterized queries should be used. Not only does it improve performance of your queries in most cases, it also makes sure that you cannot break free from strings and integers and so on throughout the SQL. There's no chance for the users to enter SQL into the predefined SQL statements, unless there's, of course, a vulnerability in the database or the libraries you're using. Those things have happened, but still, it really raises the bar with parameterized queries. It's a good way to do things. Of course, using WAFs and IPSs, you can block attacks. That's a good idea. I recommend that you create libraries. You need to make things consistent across all your applications. Using, for example, templating and libraries. Like Google, they're using templates across their web applications, and they ensure that all of those templates embed the same set of security controls to make it harder to hack. So they just, when they do code reviews, for example, everyone can make sure that for input and output, they're always using the appropriate library functions to sanitize and use built-in features of your team to basically sanitize and harden your applications. I like that idea. Of course, there's things like monitoring we got to think about. Your SIM hopefully should have a parser for your software as a services application logs. It's very useful to have those logs in your SIM, and you might be detecting attacks through that. But of course, expect the worst, expect to be hacked. Configure your databases and your web applications to use users, database users with the least amount of privileges. That's a really good idea. I've even seen this in its own defeat SQL injection. Well, basically it didn't defeat it. So here's the case, the least amount of privileges. I'm attacking a web application and a web application has a login. I break into the login field using credential stuffing. So I'm now on the inside of the web application. On the inside of the application, I find an SQL injection. I abuse the SQL injection looking for the user's table because I want hashes. Every hacker wants password hashes so we can crack them, reuse them, and start to pivot and have fun pillaging through the organization. However, the user's table, when I was running my SQL injection, I did not have permissions to select data from the user's table. In fact, this organization, they considered their web application as two different applications. One login application with one database user that has a certain set of privileges. For example, select, update, insert, delete from the user's table. And then once you log in, you're actually using a different database user for all of those queries. And that database user does not need to request anything from the user's table. And even though they had a problem with SQL injection, it wasn't that big of a deal. Amazing. That's beautiful. I love that. Of course, patching, defensive coding, stuff like that. So where are we seeing SQL injection now? Well, you shouldn't see it on Google like I showed you, but you do. So it's out there still. We did have a major, major finding in 2018 where we found more than 250 companies around the world. Their Oracle SQL databases all had on a public-facing web server SQL injection throughout everything. So it is externally, yes, still. The thing is, you might see it less. One reason is because of patching and more awareness for developers, pen testing, and so on. Another reason is because of a lot of IT operations teams. They are now disabling the error messages from the databases. So you're not seeing any SQL injection type of indicators, but the injections might still work, but you're blind. You need to use some side channel, for example, some, for example, timing or some type of indicator to find out if there's SQL injection still out there nowadays. And they are still out there. They just might be harder to find. Internal applications, very sad, but once we do internal pen tests or we have some kind of remote code execution on a host, on the inside of an organization, it's fair game to find low-hanging fruits like SQL injection all across the board. And post-logging. Now, a lot of people, organizations, they tend to like have a pen test only covering the facade of the organization, and they don't provide credentials to the pen testers. So the inside of the applications are never tested. And we do We do we thrive off credential stuffing. We even ask our clients, hey, can you supply us credentials to the web applications so that we can test it from the inside? Just because we're gonna assume one of your users or more, either A, they're malicious, maybe not, you might trust your users, or B, they lost their password and someone else is using their account to break into your organization. So post-login all the time, unfortunately. Can you imagine if we look for something else in this talk? I went through SQL injection, 20-year-old vulnerability, all right? What if I took something like cross-site scripting? Yeah, I know some of you are starting to sweat right now. What if I took something like server-side request forgery, external XML entities, password storage recommendations? Yeah, you think password storage? I tell you how to do password storage. I might recommend you to do MD5. Oh, no. You say, not MD5. MD5 has been broken. SHA-1. No. SHA-1. SHA-1 has been broken too. Collisions, you know. SHA-512. Yes. No. Password storage for solutions should be bcrypt, scrypt, pbkdf2, argon2. It needs to run through a password storage algorithm. And I think we would see hundreds of bad examples on how to store users' passwords. Salted password, for example. What about course issues, expat injection, all of these things? What if we went out there looking for them today in the stuff that I'm covering in this presentation? What do you think we would find? Secure examples or vulnerable examples? Yep. I think it's safe to conclude it's a good time to be an attacker. And if it's a good time to be an attacker, it's also a good time to be us. Security professionals, security practitioners. We're gonna have jobs for a lifetime, but it would be cool if we prevented the criminals from earning an S ton of money on cybercrime. If we could hinder them, stop them, catch more of them, etc., it would really, really be useful. And with that, I'm gonna conclude my presentation. So I want to thank you all for listening. We do have time for questions, and Carol will take care of those in a second. You can follow me on Twitter. I also have a YouTube channel, which I occasionally create some YouTube contents. I'm working on a serialization video right now that I'll be posting in a week or two. You can also add me on LinkedIn. If you add me on LinkedIn, I would appreciate that you told me that you heard my podcast or my webcast. That's how you figured out you wanted to add me on LinkedIn, so I know where you came from. And if you want to tell me if you liked it or not, that would be so awesome. I do enjoy speaking to you guys and girls, and the love for this community is great, as you can see. So let me know how you like the cast, and thank you for listening. Bye-bye. Well, questions, Carol.
All right, thanks, Chris. I'm not seeing any questions for the moment. However, if anyone has a question for Chris, please enter it into the questions window now. You have two comments. Someone says, nice chair. And another one says, this must be Chris, in quotes. I know what the first one means, but I'm not sure what the second one means, but I'm thinking maybe you do.
This must be Chris. This must be Chris. I didn't get it. Sorry.
I don't either. The person has left, so he's not going to be able to add more to it, but I thought maybe side joke you had.
I do teach two classes for exams. I teach the 504 class, the hacking techniques, instant response, and exploits. I keep this type of enthusiasm and level of presentation for 6 days straight. It's normally a very fun class. Covers a very solid baseline for the skills you need to have in order to operate better in the cybersecurity domain. And also, I'm scheduled to teach the 599 class, purple teaming, defeating advanced adversaries, and so on. Might be later this year or early next year.
All right, thanks. We've had a couple of questions come in the meantime. Let's see here. The first one asks, what do you recommend for personal user security?
Wow, that's funny you ask, because we just released a blog post on this today. not within SANS though, but I'll quickly bring it up. It's basically on netsecurity.no. It's in Norwegian, sadly. My organization is still blogging in Norwegian, but there's a lot of tips that we need to follow. Just run this article here through Google Translate. So there's a few things. For example, of course, patch. You want to patch, because if you don't patch, other people will have remote code execution on your system. If you want to translate that to layman speak, to normal people, it means if you don't patch, people can control your web camera. Encrypt your disk, never leave your computer unlocked, and there are multiple reasons why. USB stuff, don't reuse passwords, always use a password manager. Come on, it's 2020, guys, 2020. You don't need to remember any passwords except logging into your workstation and opening up your password manager. But there's some tips here I would recommend you to take a look at. Thank you for that question.
Someone has explained to us the joke. They said, that was the professor that was hacked, in quotes, who said, this must be Chris.
And they said,
a great story, by the way. So we've cleared that up. All right, let's see here. Someone else says, thanks for a great webcast, Chris. And yes, you did keep that for me in Atlanta. GCIH all the way.
So cool. Awesome.
All right. And then we've got great presentation, Chris. Very informative. And then a few more questions. What are the very best books on security you would recommend to developers in general that are not for specific programming languages?
Hands down, it's going to be the Web Applications Hacker's Handbook, second edition. The thing is, though, this book, I'll type it out, that Web Application Hacker's Handbook, second edition. It's a beautiful book. I loved it. It was like my Bible for several years. However, it's not going to come out in a third edition. In fact, the authors from this book, they have now started to create a website on portswigger.com, basically the developers of Burpsuit, and they're now offering like a web security academy online for people to run through the academy instead of putting things in a book. So they are following, let me see if I can find it. They're basically following my advice of maybe books are not the best format on learning about cybersecurity. And here you can see on this Web Security Academy, they have learning materials and labs. For example, you can run through labs on SQL injection here. You get to see what it is, how it works. It's quite good, quite beautiful. And they also have nice little labs here. You can click, you can see the goal is to perform an SQL injection attack that causes the application to display the details of all products in any category, both released and unreleased. You click access the lab, and in a few seconds, you now have a unique online lab environment where you can now try to figure out if you can find the SQL injection. And in this case, you can just start to click around, maybe look for stuff. You can see there's a product ID up here, product ID equals 8. It might be vulnerable. You can maybe plug in a little tick up here to the pets. Now you can see an internal server error. Interesting. What if we do a tick or 1 equals 1? See if something happens. And congratulations, you solved the lab. And they go from very basic to very advanced, from blind timing attacks and so on. They even, in some cases, provide you with like an exploit server. So they have a web server for you where you can basically send exploit code to victims. It's a beautiful setup. So I hope you check it out. Thanks for asking.
All right, thanks. What do you think about DNS filtering? Is there any favorite DNS filtering service?
DNS filtering is a good idea. I don't recommend vendors, but basically maybe you have a next generation firewall, for example, that would allow you to filter on, first of all, sinkhole bad domains, and maybe also do outbound filtering to make sure that people are not visiting known phishing domains or unknown domains, newly born domains, and malicious domains. But I don't recommend vendors just because, you know, I don't like recommending vendors. Sorry.
Thanks. Well, with that comment, I guess somebody asks, what personal password manager do you recommend? But I'm guessing you can't address that one.
Well, that's an exception. All right. So I use the free open source KeePass, which is, for your information, it's enclosed within the bug bounty of Europe. So they have a nice bug bounty program for it. It's actively being developed. It receives a lot of scrutiny. I've been using it for more than 7 years now. I have more than 1,000 accounts in this database. Every single password that I hold, with the exception of a few lab passwords, are strong and unique passwords, and I can prove it. And KeePass, it's been with me for so long. There is no scenario I haven't been able to solve with KeePass. I've been in basements where there is no internet connection. I've been at the consoles and data centers. I've been everywhere with this KeePass database, having to provide a password that I don't know, and it's never failed me. So I love KeePass. I want to keep us.
Thank you. A couple more people are complimenting you. Great presentation. Someone says, talking about preaching to the believers. Thanks. Thanks still, Chris, on the emphasis. We, meaning the InfoSec community, would need you to speak to all the masses and the management.
Oh, yeah.
So next question. After all of your bashing of the various study materials for coding in PHP, what do you recommend that is not total crap?
Which programming language do I recommend that isn't total crap? The problem is a lot of the languages, they want to make it as easy as possible to perform operations. So to maybe query a database, they want to just make it work. And they're kind of competing for the user base. And if the development languages keep adding security on top of their frameworks, perhaps hindering developers so they can't necessarily perform what they need to perform, it could impact their user bases. And that could be a reason why they're not necessarily making things secure by default. To answer your question though, I wish I knew of a language that was more inherently secure by default. So if anyone knows of such a language that you would recommend someone, maybe let us know on Twitter, for example, tag me on Twitter posts. But unfortunately, I am not sure. So we see these problems across at least all of the programming languages and the online web solutions that we're targeting. Even NoSQL has like NoSQL injection. So MongoDB databases, Redis and so on. There's just a lot of weaknesses.
All right, thanks. Going back to the question about the password manager, someone says, is there something wrong with using LastPass or 1Password? Or just that's your preference, the other ones are your preference?
Yeah, so KeePass is my preference. I also do have some requirements for my database. I need to synchronize it using a cloud platform. I need to synchronize to my phone. I can't have it in my browser because I need to have this KeePass, or this password manager, sorry, I need to have it to be able to type in passwords for me. So it needs to select a window and type in a password because, say, for example, in RDP, in some cases, you're going to change your password. You can't paste in those windows. And I don't like to have it in my browser because a lot of my applications are SSH or SMB or otherwise not web only, right? But use whatever floats your boat. But in 2020, password managers are a requirement. Same thing as I'm going to say something crazy now. For regular users, this is a requirement. A VPN. It's like a crazy, I'm dropping the bomb, but a VPN is actually a requirement for regular users to have and use. We have to address the issues. A lot of people tell me that, look, my users they're not smart enough to use a password manager. Chris, you don't know the masses. You don't know how people think and are. And I say, I know most people. Most people are smart enough to open up a program like this. Let me show you. Open up a program like this, type in Facebook, click an entry, press Control V or whatever, right click and copy passwords, for example. Everyone can do that. If you cannot do this, if you cannot operate such a simple tool, type in 1Password, search for Facebook or whatever you want to log into, you're not even capable of operating Outlook or whatever other systems you're using. And that's fine, all right? That's perfectly fine. We have those users. I'm not arguing with that, but those are the exceptions. Maybe for those exceptions, we're going to give them one of these. So on my web camera right now, for those of you looking at the recording, you're not seeing this, but I'm showing you a YubiKey. I'm showing you multi-factor authentication. For those users who need to have a weak password synchronized across all their services, give them a token, and they will find that token is actually pretty cool to have. That they will tell their friends, hey, Charlie, look at this. You want to see me log into my workstation today? I have to plug in this thing on my keychain to make it work. Isn't that pretty awesome? And when I unplug it, it automatically logs me off. That's pretty cool in my opinion. But then again, I'm a geek and I'm a nerd, so I might be mistaken on this, but password managers, you can't really get around it anymore.
All right, thanks. Are there any podcast or blog resources you would recommend listening to or following to keep up with security news and information?
So I use So in terms of web security, I want you to at least pay attention to whatever these guys are putting out there, right? These guys here also have a guy called James Kettle. On Twitter, his handle is AlbinoWax. AlbinoWax. And he posts amazing web security stuff. And just by following him, you will stay on top on a lot of the modern techniques of web exploitation and so on. And also on this blog that they have behind this web academy. I mean, not the web academy itself, but the blog behind this everything is beautiful to pay attention to as well. In terms of staying up to date to security topics and news, etc., I tend to follow Twitter. I listen to my colleagues, whatever they're posting on. We have like Microsoft Teams and people are posting news there quite regularly whenever there's something happening. I don't read a lot of news though, but I do hang around Reddit, NetSec subreddit sometimes. And also on Twitter, I tend to pay a little bit attention to Twitter to see if there's something trending or something major going on. That's just what I do. There's of course other things to mention. Check out the SANS Storm Centers, the Internet Storm Centers. They have every day, Johannes Ulrich, he has like a 5-minute podcast on the latest things developing in the security sphere. Every day is 5 minutes, and I don't think, someone told me, he haven't missed a single day, and it's been going for multiple years. Check that out. I can't remember the exact name of it, but it should be a good one.
All right, thanks. Do you host your own infrastructure privately, like DNS, mail, virtualization? I find that it takes more and more time as it grows with features. Other colleagues just buy services and have a private life.
So the whole trade-off of moving to cloud or not, there are really, really good trade-offs for moving to the cloud in terms of management, overhead, in patching, like, think of all the things you have to think about if you're going to run, say, something simple as a network. You need to keep the firmware up to date. You need to have skills to operate the technology. You need to reconfigure the things at intervals when you need something to happen. But within a cloud environment, you have so many ease of use things ready for you. So in my environment, I'm a mix of both cloud and also hosting things for my own. The things I host for myself is mostly for labbing, proof of concepts, staging, and development stuff.
All right, thanks. We'll squeeze one or two more in here. Thanks a lot for the presentation, Chris. I'm interested in OT security of critical infrastructure. In your experience, how would you describe the level of IT security of public utilities? Is it as bad as the general picture you described today?
Yes, so that's, you're now mentioning like almost like a curse word in info security, because operational technology, it's the worst. Like, there's just old vulnerable systems. Like, you will see Windows NT and Linux kernels that were released from before I was born even, and they're running mission critical systems, right? And you can't get rid of it. That's just the modus operandi. That's just how you run your operations. So with OT comes a lot of security vulnerabilities, but different ways to solve them. So instead of solving vulnerabilities, say for example, I'm forcing you to patch Windows NT, it's just not gonna happen. It's gonna break all the machines running it. We could say that we're gonna try to mitigate the problems, and we're gonna mitigate it in terms of say, do some zero trust network architecture, maybe do some segmentation at the same time, maybe air gap our networks. And instead of trying to remove the problem, you're just mitigating to the point where there are so many barriers to walk through that most attackers are not going to make it. The problem with OT arises when those barriers are not good enough, or when some guy plugs in a CAN bus or Modbus to Ethernet module and publicly on the internet is hosting some kind of thingy, right? The internet of bad things. That's when things happen, when all of a sudden you have an Ethernet-enabled device that previously have just been locally on a network running CAN bus operations, for example, or CAN bus traffic.
All right, well, that's all the time we have for today. Thank you so much, Chris, for your great presentation, which helps bring this content to the SANS community. To our audience, we greatly appreciate you listening in. For a schedule of all upcoming and archived SANS webcasts, including this one, please visit sans.org/webcasts. Until next time, take care, and we hope to have you back again for the next SANS webcast.